I'm really pleased to be with you today. I've just come this morning from the Intra-Africa Trade Fair, where hundreds of companies across the continent are displaying products that are made or developed on the African continent. And it's part of a much wider effort to build a common African perspective through a free trade agreement that is envisaged to cover eventually 54 countries and 1.2 billion consumers. And at that trade fair, we've had heads of state from Nigeria to the Prime Minister of Rwanda, the President of South Africa, Zambia, and others, sharing their perspectives and their optimism about the opportunities that the continent faces. This has also been a week that has underlined that KwaZulu-Natal is open for business, that it's recovering from the difficult times of the COVID lockdown and the more recent week of unrest. And this comes off the back, as the MEC has indicated, of a number of announcements and decisions that's boosted confidence in the regional economy. I was here a few weeks ago to launch with President Ramaphosa the new Corolla Cross vehicle. It is Africa's first hybrid that is produced on commercial scale. And it's a vehicle that has benefited from increased localization, so more components are manufactured here in South Africa. And that vehicle now will be exported by Toyota to many different parts of the continent and elsewhere. And so you may ask the question, what's the connection between the Intra-Africa Trade Fair, the launch of a car, of a new production vehicle, and of our discussion today on a Global Business Services Master Plan? They're all indications that in spite of enormous challenges, we are plotting a way forward as a country and as a continent, and we're very confident that we would be able to see over the next number of years increased investment in South Africa and the rest of the continent, and with that, more jobs and more opportunity. Today's session, of course, is really about the framework of a master plan to grow the global business services sector in South Africa. Many of the CEOs present here today will recall that we met virtually in June this year, and we agreed that we would flesh out a partnership that has been going on for a number of years and give it a little bit more substance in the form of, let's call it, a higher level partnership agreement, namely a master plan. And the intention of that master plan was to grow the industry, building on South Africa's inherent advantages and strengths, and complement those strengths with some additional effort and actions by government and by the industry with its partners to lift the rate of growth further. I want to acknowledge that Andy and his team, together with the CEOs that gives him his mandate, have been hard at work, as has Yunus and Reshni and the team. And they've been assisted by Mark and the Genesis team. And they've been panel beating a number of ideas that we've been talking about in June and prior to June into a coherent framework. We have a draft master plan available that has been tabled to all of us today. It's a very useful framework for the industry. And sufficient progress has been made between June this year and today for the document to be initialed and signed in this public ceremony. And then next year, when we have finalized all of the implementation modalities, we're going to do a public launch of the document. And in that public launch, we will have an event with representatives from across the country. More government departments will be invited to that, because we're going to build partnerships with a number of them. And we'll announce then some of the clear targets that we've set ourselves. We want to now focus on getting the document ready for first phase implementation. South Africa has been focusing for a number of years now on building on its comparative advantage in consumer customer experience outsourcing. So that has built the sector to date. And it's evolved into an end-to-end consumer life cycle management. And I saw an example of it an hour and a half ago, I guess, ago, as I walked through the facility here. And this system that we're building, which consists of a number of firms rendering services, rests on a digital platform. It requires skilled labor from across the country, and it needs a marketing strategy to catch the attention of customers elsewhere in the world. South Africa's ability to attract the investment required to support growth will be determined by our relative cost competitiveness combined with a compelling value proposition that we put forward. What is it that decides, that makes a company decide to locate in South Africa as opposed to anywhere else in the world? So we will look at strategies for cost competitiveness. They're always important. But South Africa is not going to compete on the basis that we are the lowest cost producer. That's not where we are. That's not our inherent strength. It's critical, therefore, that the industry is able to identify, communicate, and deliver on that unique comparative advantage that accounts for the country's position on that cost continuum. Not lowest cost, not highest cost. We're somewhere on that continuum, but we bring something that we think no one else brings. And the master plan has identified a number of areas where this unique advantage is being demonstrated through improved customer lifetime value, the excellent quality outsourcing that you produce. But the sector will need to identify its areas of additional unique advantage in other service offerings. I'm looking in particular, and listened carefully as I walked on the shop floor earlier, at how we can move into these new markets: personalized and social services in education, healthcare, and leisure, and the range of technical services that the master plan refers to. Now, some of the factors that we may want to take into account in considering our advantage would include the following: that our advantage at a much lower cost compared to source markets is important. So when an airline that operates in the United States want to source that service, we can offer it cheaper. And underpinning that is our CX expertise, our proficient verbal and written communication skills, and something that I have recognized before I came here today, but I found further evidence of it, and that is the high level of empathy. That quality that South Africans bring when they're on the telephone to solve a problem, that we may not be the best at the kind of mechanical application. If you have this problem, I'm going to tick this box and I'm going to take this little sub-question. But what South African workers bring, I'm assured by Martin, by Andy, and by a number of you that I've spoken of, is a problem-solving capability and capacity. South Africa was voted the most favored offshore CX delivery location in the world earlier this year. We have a niche domain skill base. When I visited East London, Buffalo City in June this year, we launched the C-Class Mercedes-Benz. I was struck by the fact that Mercedes-Benz had a bigger digital services hub in South Africa with skilled personnel than anywhere else in the Mercedes-Benz group outside of Germany. And that was rendering services to the production floors of Mercedes elsewhere in the world. So it's really taking that knowledge and making it available for verticals which are in high demand in target source market like the United States and in the UK. And you know those markets well. They include insurance, financial services, healthcare, legal services. Our locational advantages, certainly in respect of Europe, will also play in our favor. And it can provide the basis on which the sector can diversify into niche business processes and back office functions in all these verticals. You, the sector, the country has a track record of resilience. It's been demonstrated by the ability to adapt. We've got more recently in your sector flexible work from home models that are developing, and it's enabled continuity of business operations even during economic shocks. I gave a speech not very long ago to a group of investors in London highlighting the advantages of South Africa as a location, and you'll be familiar because you do the pitch every day for business on it. I pointed to our digital infrastructure compared to a number of competing locations, our price competitiveness, certainly in respect of host country or home country location, so compared to UK cost, our strong and diverse talent pool, including the strong language skills to English-speaking jurisdictions, the strong customer service culture and the ability to service customers with multiple services, tech support, voice support, and so on. The deep domestic market experience. We have banking and tech experience in our domestic market, so we can draw a middle layer of skills from other support areas. We also have choice in destination, Cape Town, Durban, Gqeberha, Buffalo City, Joburg, Tshwane. Those are just six top destinations where UK companies are in four of those six. Once you go to Maritzburg and you move out of your main metros, you expand the number of areas that can be available. It's easy to contract with South Africa. We have similar legal systems to many of the countries that we service. South Africa also is in many respects compliant with privacy rules that you find in Europe, in the United Kingdom. And our legislation, POPI, is aligned with the UK law, the GDPR. There's also time zone advantages, although I want to emphasize that we're looking not only north, but we're also focusing on ensuring that we look west. And of course, there are English jurisdictions to our east. So, how does the master plan play to these? To make a few observations on the master plan. First thing that you'll notice with the master plan is we've titled it as a master plan 1.0. And the idea is that it's a living document, that it's going to develop and grow as the industry develops. And so we're not going to be shy from time to time to take the lessons and incorporate it in how we go about setting targets and developing strategies. So you'll see with time a 1.1, a 1.2 for small amendments. And when we're ready to make a large adjustment to our plans, as we build deeper levels of confidence and we see the successes we're making, we'll move to a master plan 2.0. So this is something that the industry and government will be co-shaping with organized labor coming in, the business executives coming in, other government departments contributing. The second characteristic of the master plan that I point to is it has four scenarios. And the rationale for that is the growth of the sector is not a function of a mechanical set of actions that we take. We're playing in a fluid environment where other countries are offering and are attracting CX and other services, but also the conditions and the technologies are changing. Artificial intelligence, the use of algorithms mean that the value proposition has to be refreshed regularly. Opportunities that arise, COVID has been both a knock for businesses, but it's also got everybody to think in new ways about digital platforms for delivery. And we will see, as a legacy of COVID, a stronger reliance on digital platforms in future. And this is a sector that can leverage off digital platforms. We have a baseline scenario, one that says if the DTIC maintains its current platform of support and the industry does the kind of things that it does at the moment, how do we see growth in the next few years? We have an extended target, an accelerated target, and a highest growth target. And the idea with each of these would be to set a series of commitments. And as we meet those commitments, we can either move into the expanded target or we can move into the accelerated target. So it's a flexible framework that we've created. We recognize that in this version of the master plan, we're looking at new jobs that will grow. But one of the areas we're going to be looking at in the next few weeks is how we can deepen job retention strategies and what numbers will come out of the mix. What can we see in 3 years, 6 years, 9, 10 years time as the total employment in the sector? And this is going to be an area of some work that we'll do over the next few weeks. Andy has spoken on many of the components of the master plan. It has a demand side, how to bring more global business to South Africa. It's got a supply side, what we can do on skills, on data, on infrastructure, and it's a transformation vision. It sets itself a number of goals. I want to point to one, and that is the move up the value chain through a menu of choices. So we want to continue to have a big presence in CX. So customer experience is going to be a big part of what South Africa offers for many, many years. It's an entry point to bring large numbers of South African young people into employment. But at the same time, we want to see how we can create jobs in digital and IT support services, in finance, in legal services, medical services, and so on. As the fourth industrial revolution reshapes our world and medical services are rendered much more off these platforms, this becomes the new frontier for global services. The fourth area I want to focus on is impact sourcing. Opportunity the master plan gives us is to ensure that youth from disadvantaged backgrounds are given priority. We met a young woman earlier and she complained that as a result of some skin challenge that she faces, she can't find jobs in other sectors where you meet customers directly. And this provides an opportunity for her. I've met young people who were unemployed before they came into the sector and who had stared unemployment in the face for a period. And so it provides an opportunity, sometimes not the final place where people land, often a stepping stone to something else. We're looking at spatial development, providing a greater provincial spread, which also de-risks the sector for investors and provide opportunity outside the main metro. So you'll see in the document the reference to tier 2 and tier 3 locations. And one of the areas that I would like the sector to look at is how it can play a bigger role in retraining and recruitment of workers displaced by industrial restructuring in other sectors of the economy. Economies are dynamic. Jobs are lost in areas, jobs are gained in other areas, and this can be a breach. Next, I want to focus on the ecosystem in the master plan. It doesn't have only a funding element. In other words, the size of the incentive is a range of support services and actions that we need to work on, from the stability and cost of our data networks and the skills that are developed and the adaptability of workers to the new environment. So we're going a route that is not simply going to be driven by the size of the incentive, but it's the attractiveness of that entire ecosystem that we hope can not only attract, but more importantly, retain business, global business services in South Africa. You'll see in the master plan a set of joint commitments. There's no free lunch here. So government is not there simply to sign the document. There's a number of commitments, MEC Pillay, that the state will undertake. Andy and your team, there's a range of commitments by businesses. And then finally, it's about the transformation agenda, promoting decent work, skill development, and ownership. As consumers across the world become more aware of conditions in which work is performed, you'd be able to position this jurisdiction, South Africa, as one that has an environment in which the basic rights of people are respected, and in that way, I hope you can win more businesses. I want to conclude now and say that the master plan is an industry compact. It's a social compact between players in an industry. It provides a framework. We now need to spell out and refine some of the detail of it. We've given ourselves in the document we're going to sign until mid-January to complete four tasks. The first would be to refine the job numbers, including establishing what we call net job markers. In other words, the range of total jobs that the industry want to be able to sustain at given points. We want to carefully align the narrative and the implementation plan, and the team has done an excellent job so far. There's a little bit of panel beating that they will do. We want to stress test the deadline of specific actions. When we go out publicly to South Africans with deadlines, we want to know they're credible, and I want to hear from you that you feel they're completely credible. And finally, we want to have an opportunity to strengthen further the partnership by different government departments for the master plan. We've been really supported by a range of government departments. The Department of Higher Education and Training has been a strong backer and supporter. Some of the provinces have been. We want to reach out to all of the provinces and the metros and make sure that they are as enthusiastic as MEC Pillay is, and that we can then have more opportunities. So what we're doing now is we're initialing the document in the language of the lawyers, indicating that we're comfortable with the framework, that this is the framework we're working on. We're giving ourselves a few weeks to refine these four areas that I've identified. We'll then take them through the necessary processes. We'll then have a large public ceremony next year, early next year. It will probably coincide around the time of the State of the Nation address, and it would give us an opportunity to tell South Africans in detail what the various commitments are, what the time frames are, and what the targeted total jobs are that we will achieve. So my congratulations to the team that has worked so hard to bring all of this together. And it's one more success story that we can chalk up that lays the basis for opportunities for more jobs for young people and for women. And so to the department officials that have worked hard on this, to the CEOs and BEPESA who have been good partners in this entire process, well done on pulling us as far as you have in as little time as you have. This is one of the shortest periods to have completed a master plan with a substantial amount of technical work and modeling that underpins it, and all of you have contributed to that. So thank you very much, DG Malebo, Mabichi Thompson. I think you're going to lead us in the signing ceremony. You'll point us to the dotted lines, and we'll get the CEOs and government to seal the partnership. Thank you very much, everyone.